This is Huawei's MateStation X. It's an all-in-one Windows 11 PC. Now, it comes with a stunning 4K display. It's 28.2 inches. Visa HDR 400 certified. It does support touch, and it gives you 10 touch points with this display. Now, it's got built-in speakers, three in total, and it's got a CNC machine built to it. Now, it's running the Ryzen 7 5800H as its APU with Vega 8 graphics. It does come with 16 gigabytes of RAM and dual channel, a 512 gigabyte SSD, Wi-Fi 6, and it does support Huawei's super device for seamless connectivity between other Huawei devices like the MatePad and the Mate X2 I have here.
Now, this is what is included with the MateStation X. You get the keyboard, Bluetooth, more on that soon, a power cable, and a mouse. So this keyboard is a very nice keyboard. I do like it. Now, we've got Huawei Share right here with the shift key. That's using NFC. So if you have another Huawei device, you hold it over that, it will then connect up, pair up. Fingerprint reader right here, and it is Bluetooth. Now, typing on this keyboard, very nice and comfortable. It's got good travel, so it's similar to a laptop keyboard, but you gain more travel. It's about 1.6, 1.7 or so millimeters of travel there with a good feeling to the keys. Now, the keyboard is not backlit, but it's of good quality. Metal frame around it, there's no flex, and there's no bounce at all coming from this keyboard. Now, the mouse quality doesn't feel quite as good as the keyboard. It is quite lightweight, plastic, and we do have a metal scroll wheel, third mouse button when you press it in, left and right mouse buttons there, and it is using an optical sensor. It just feels a bit cheaper than that keyboard. That's the only complaint from me, and I wish the size of it was a little bit larger. I do find it to be a little small, the size of this mouse. The MateStation X build quality is top notch. It is excellent. It does have CNC machining. It's made out of alloy that does have a matte finish to it. And it looks great. And you can see the big Huawei logo there at the back of it. The base is very solid. It's not going anywhere. When you tap on that screen, it does not rock around. And you can see where the power plug connects in the back there. So on the right of the stand here, we've got two type A USB 3.1s and our power on button. Then on the left side, two type C's, they are USB 3.1 Gen 1 and a 3.5mm combo headphone jack. Now side on, it looks very thin. Now I've got it angled right up the screen. This is the maximum you can tilt it up. You cannot tilt it down. You cannot adjust the height either, and it cannot be swiveled. So it's a little limited there. However, Huawei has optimized it for use on a desk. So I believe the height of it is good. You just need to adjust your seat height if you can do so. Now there's no HDMI input with this, and there's also no upgrades. There's no way to get inside it, which is a shame. And onto our display now. So this one is 28.2 inches and it's a very vibrant display. Touch that it does support 4K plus resolution. So the maximum brightness, Huawei's claim is 500 nits, but I'm able to achieve 536 nits, which is excellent. So the touch response, the accuracy, I do find to be very good. No problems at all with it. It does add to the productivity, the fact that you can swap over to files, folders, drag and drop everything, and just use your finger on such a nice display, which is excellent. So the color coverage, we've got 96% of P3, Adobe RGB, that is 87%, NTSC is 85%, and then 100% sRGB. So it is a professional grade screen that they do have in this, the IPS. Now, to my eyes, it does not look fully laminated. There's a slight gap between the touch digitizer glass and then that IPS below. But overall, it's an excellent screen, and I just wish it had HDMI input. It's the only thing it's lacking, so I could plug in other devices to enjoy the screen. The MateStation X does ship with Windows 11 Home. It's fully activated via a digital license there, so no problems with that. And we do have the 16 gigabytes of RAM and a 512 gigabyte SSD, as I mentioned. Now, the SSD speeds are quick. This is a PCIe 3 SSD, so it doesn't support PCIe 4 spec, not at this stage with the 5000 series of the AMD chips. That'll come later with the 6000 series, of course. They will eventually be upgrading to that. Now, under the device manager, you will see just a couple of things I wanted to point out here. You'll see the fingerprint reader under biometrics. And that is a CPC fingerprint reader, and it does seem to work fine. That's the one that's on the keyboard there, of course. And you'll see there's our disk drive, which is a J Micron one. Now, I do have an external drive connected up at the moment. That's why you also see that listed there. So our display, of course, is running off the Vega. That's Vega 8 graphics, and the processor is listed, that Ryzen 7, the 5800H, 16 times because it's 8 cores, 16 threads, and I'll get onto the performance of that just in a second. So wireless is handled by the Wi-Fi AX200. This is a very good chip, very fast, to get about 1.3 gigabit transfers. It does have Bluetooth 5.2 with it, and there's really nothing else there of interest. The network cards, well, there is no LAN port on this either, so it's just wireless. So they are missing out on that. Now, the performance of it, let's get on to some benchmarks here. So you can see that it is very capable, very, very quick here, with the Geekbench 5 score getting close to 1,500 points, multi-core score around 8,000, which is pretty standard there for the Ryzen 7 5800H. And there are a couple of 3DMark benchmarks I did run. Even though this does not have a dedicated GPU, the Vega graphics actually does okay. Graphics score there getting close to 3,700. And this is the Night Raid, which is more for integrated graphics. They say to test this one, graphics score getting up and just over 14,000 points there, which is good. And our Cinebench score, very good. This is excellent. So 1,400 single core. And then we have over 11,000 points there for the multi-core score. So it is a very quick PC, and everything's blazing fast, so no point me going over your standard kind of tasks on a PC like this because it's very quick. But YouTube 4K performance, I'm going to have a look at now. This is with Chrome, so we'll see how quick it does load in and the performance, if it's going to drop any frames. So the 4K demo file should show up, the one that I normally test out, which is this one, Sony's 4K demo. So we'll enable our stats here for nerds, but I'll set it first to our 4K resolution, and I'll enable those stats. Now, I don't have the best internet connection, but it should hopefully be able to handle this. You can see so far zero dropped frames, which is excellent. I'll just skip ahead a little bit. It's not dropping any frames, and that is running at full screen now. No drop frames. I can't seem to resize and move that, but you get the idea that it does handle 4K 30 just fine. But what about 4K 60 with the Ryzen 7 5800H? And for this test, it is a LG demo file. So three frames have dropped, 61 now. Now that could actually be down to my internet connection. The buffer health is zero. So there we go. That's the problem of my internet connection. But when you do have fast enough internet for 4K 60, which I'm currently lacking right here, and then it shouldn't drop any frames either. The Vega 8 graphics can handle it. And of course, it does support Huawei's super device. And if you do have another Huawei device that's logged in with the same ID, for example, I've got my MatePad right here and the Huawei Mate X2, I can then seamlessly drop over files between them. And it's great for doing that, multi-screen support as well. So I can share the screen, have it come up on there too. And it's excellent for that. You've also got Huawei Share and the driver updates and everything with their own built-in software. And then we've got some fantastic audio with this model here. So it does have two full range speakers, but also a sub built in. So you get a bit of bass too. The volume out of this all-in-one PC is great. And they've done a very, very good job with the audio. So here's a sample at 100% volume. And this is our webcam quality, what you can expect out of it. So it's a HD webcam. You're listening to audio that's recorded through the inbuilt microphones. And it does have a status LED next to that camera. So it is, I think, the quality here reasonably good. And it's going to be perfect for things like Skype, Zoom, your online conference calls, whatever you need with an all-in-one PC like this. And what about gaming performance? Can the Vega 8 in this Ryzen 7 game? Well, this is The Witcher
3, and I do have it set to 720p. And I'm in the town here. This is one of the bigger towns of the game, and where it is the most demanding. That's why I always test out this area, because there's a lot of NPCs, a lot to render, and we are getting just over 30 frames per second. So even a demanding game like this, I know it is old, but it is just playable on the low settings, and as mentioned, 720p. But at least you can do this with the Vega 8 graphics. Grand Theft Auto 5, so I do have it set to 1080p normal settings, and you can see out here in the street at getting around close to 70 frames per second sometimes, which is very good. You see the clock there on the Vega 8, so the GPU is holding the 2000 megahertz and it does not throttle down, which is great. That's what we want to see. We don't want to see it throttling due to temperatures and thermals, which I'll get onto shortly. So performance is looking good. In the car, a little bit slower here, down to just under 60 frames per second. But not bad at all for an older title like GTA 5 here. Fan noise and thermals are excellent on the MateStation X, so it is only getting up to almost 90 degrees Celsius with ambient 25 to 24 degree temperatures in the room here where I'm testing. And the fan, it's a silent all-in-one PC. Apart from when you game or do something very demanding, you can just hear the fan, but it is very quiet. So can this Ryzen 7, the 5800H, handle something demanding like video editing? It can. Now, just basic 4K edits is all I have in my timeline right here. And the playback resolution I do have set to 1/4, and it does seem quick. Now, normally with a very detailed, in-depth kind of review that I do have, and if it's got a lot of transitions and layers and whatnot, you really do need a dedicated GPU. But the Ryzen 7 can handle this, just the more basic edit. So let's have a look at the export time now for 1 minute of footage. And it has just finished up. That was about 43 seconds, taking into account my delay there with the timer. So that's quick. Under 1 minute is excellent. Now you can access the BIOS with it, but not a lot we can do here. Everything is basically locked down. There's just some settings here. For example, if you want to turn off the camera, the audio, wireless LAN, Bluetooth, things like that, you can do that. Boot order and bootable devices there. That is it when it comes to our BIOS settings with the MateStation X. And I do have some mostly good news here for Linux lovers out there that want to run Linux on the MateStation X. It works. Touch is working, okay? You can see that I can select things, move that around. Audio does work. Wireless is working. The only thing is the brightness control seems to do nothing. So there is a bit of tweaking there with the drivers in order to get that to work, because right now I think it is running just basically in the absolute top brightness here, which is 530 something nits. All right then, so what is the final verdict here with the Huawei MateStation X? I think it's a fantastic all-in-one PC. Comes with Windows 11, it has a touch screen, it's got that anti-glare coating, so it doesn't look as bad as you would think it would being glass covered with the touch digitizer on it. Now it's HDR 400, the brightness tops out over 500 nits, which is excellent, but sadly there is no HDMI input on this base at all, so we cannot, for example, decide to play PlayStation through it, Xbox through it, connect up other devices. Now you can do it with Windows 11 wirelessly. You can use super device as well that Huawei has, so I can seamlessly connect and work with, for example, my MatePad, the Mate X2, and transfer files over and even screen sharing and things like that, which is handy, very, very good to have. It's just if it did have HDMI input and could be used also as a monitor, would have been very good. Now there's no upgrade ability either with it, so you cannot just go along and stick 32 gigabytes of RAM in this. You can't add another 1 terabyte SSD to it. Unfortunately, that's not an option. What would also have been good from Huawei is an optional dedicated GPU, even if it's just a mobile one. After all, it's got a mobile part in it. But if we had the option to use or add an RTX 3050 or a 3060, it would have been perfect for more serious 3D work. For video editing, it would help out. You can do a bit of it, as I showed you, 4K video editing, you can do a little bit of gaming. But if it had a dedicated GPU, you could get even further use out of such a great all-in-one PC here. So the build quality, overall look of it, I think is very, very stylish. It's fantastic. It's just it has its limitations, as I have pointed out here. So thank you so much for watching my review of the MateStation X from Huawei.